Welcome back to the lecture about applied bioimage analysis. This part is about image tail macro programming and especially how to record macros and how to work with images. Let's start with the second part first. So if you want to work with images, of course, you want to open these images and you want to close them when you're done with it. So open and close are the two commands to go, and you find them on the cheat sheets. Then you can do with images some let's call it some basic analysis. So if you want to read out how wide and how high an image is, or how large pixels in an image are, you can use these commands: get width, get height, get pixel size. You also find them on the cheat sheet. And you can print it out, for example, with the print statement like this. Again, you find in the folder next to the slides, you find these example scripts. You don't have to type it from the YouTube slides. And furthermore, basic statistics. So this is feature extraction of a whole image. If you want to know the area of an image or the mean intensity, minimum, maximum intensity, standard deviation, you can use the get statistics method. And you can also print out these values if you just want to have some general basic statistical information about a whole image. And that's basically the most important commands which you will still type yourself. Most of the other stuff is recorded. So this is a special thing for ImageJ. And I think that's why ImageJ is so popular among biologists, and that programming is not done by using your keyboard. It's used by recording. And I would like to show you how this works. So let's assume I have ImageJ open and I open one of my favorite images. Blobs.gif. So I want to process this image now. I want to apply a filter to this image. I want to do a thresholding. I want to label the objects which are segmented afterwards. This connected components analysis in ImageJ called the particle analyzer. And then I want to do some feature extraction of the objects I find here. And that's all things. Yeah, that's all things I showed you already. And now we do it. We will do these steps again, the steps you trained already last week. But we will do it while having the recorder on. It works like that. You go to the plugins menu, macros, and there is a record menu down here. And you open this window and you put it to the side. Actually, I would recommend opening this window always when working with ImageJ. And now when I do things, you will see that it will record stuff here in this window. So let's, for example, take our image and apply a filter to it. For example, a Gaussian blur. So I will now apply a Gaussian blur with a radius of 3 to this particular image. And when I click OK, this image is blurred. And I can read here the ImageJ macro command, which corresponds to the operation I just did. Furthermore, you see here that the 3 I entered also shows up in this command. And now let's have a look at the Gaussian blur again. Yeah. You see here it says sigma here in the recording, and here it says sigma in the window, and that's kind of related. So whenever we have a dialogue like this one and there is a description of parameters here, it always takes the first part of these parameters, usually the one before the first space, and writes it into this command. So I could sit down and I could write run Gaussian blur or sigma equals 3. I could write it by hand and script it, not just as I just did it with other commands. But of course, recording is much easier. And also the likelihood of doing typos is almost zero when you go this way. And that's why I use the recorder every day, all the time, in order to record my programs instead of typing them. And when I click OK, it will be recorded again. And now my image is heavily blurred. From time to time, especially when you start developing a new workflow for a new image, I would recommend to clean up the window, the recorder, to close all your images and start from the beginning, because you were now playing a bit with the Gaussian blur. Now you know, okay, maybe sigma 3 is right. So let's start from the beginning. We open again the image. Now you see here it's also recording. In this case, it's recording something. Then we apply the Gaussian blur with a radius of 3. So maybe we wrote down on a sheet of paper 3 was a good value, right? And then we can execute this one. Then we do a thresholding, which is image adjust threshold. And when you now look into the blobs.gif, you will see, okay, obviously the objects are not segmented at the moment, so the objects are not red, the background is red. So I have to change this checkbox here. Then I can also play with different algorithms for segmentation, and you see whenever I pick a new one here in this pulldown, it is recording all that. So after some time, I may realize, okay, the default algorithm was actually the best one for my particular image, for this particular image. And you will see, okay, it's recording a lot of stuff, which is actually not necessary to do the final step I am doing now. I will click apply to get my binary image out. I will also close this window, and it is recording close here at that point, and it recorded a lot of stuff. So I remember that we did a Gaussian blur at some point, and then afterwards there was thresholding. So I enter now some empty lines here, and I can also put a comment here like thresholding to keep track of what's actually happening. And I can also here put another comment filtering, and I can put another comment here open the file. And that's already, I'm already cleaning up my recorded macro, because it will become very long. The longer my workflow becomes, the longer this text will become. And just to keep track of what's going on here, I will put some comments in. Furthermore, what I will do now, you could do it later for sure. I was going through different algorithms. I tried default with the dark background checkbox on. Then I turned off this checkbox, and I tried Huang and IsoData and IJRM, and I came back to default. So this is all things I tried. So they were not actually done. The last thing was done. That's why I can remove all these, and then my program becomes already shorter. So let's continue. We want to do, okay, but back to the image. We want to do connected components analysis. Connected components analysis labeling is in the analyze particle menu in ImageJ. And you know this window already, and depending on what you want to do, you can now pick different options here. So for example, I would like to measure something of these objects. So I want to display results, which leads to the results table after clicking OK here. And furthermore, I would like to visualize the label map, which is called count masks in this pulldown. And when I click OK, so yeah, I checked display results, and I configured count masks. You realize that all the things I changed in this window are now written down in the recorder. So, and if you are used to the analyze particles window, for example, let me just repeat it with some different operations. When you are used to the particle analyzer, you will realize that, for example, if you want to add something to the ROI manager, it will record add here. And when you are used to that, you can also type that yourself, sure. But for the moment, I would recommend you processing these steps and always looking into the recorder what it is recording right now, because this is actually this little white window programmed in the late 90s or something like in the early 2000s. This little window will teach you programming now, because it is writing the program of what you're doing while you are doing it. Okay, one last thing. The visualization here does not look very good. We cannot really see the objects. That's why we choose a different lookup table, for example, Glass Bay on dark. And also this is recorded. Yeah. And here in this case, you see actually kind of obvious that says run, and then in brackets and in string behind, it's actually just the menu name. Yeah, so here Glass Bay on dark, and here it says Glass Bay on dark. So it is as simple as that. It will put behind the run command, it will put the menu you clicked. And if I now click on create, I get the actual script, you know, with the nice colors, and then I can edit this program. And then you go through the program again, of course. And from the top to the bottom, I already put some comments here. If you wouldn't have done that already, do it now. Write comments in between. So for example, here I can now put my additional comment. Connected components analysis. And clean up this code. So you will find places where you executed a command twice. But in fact, you don't want to do that. You want to analyze the image once, right? There's also a close recorded here in between. But maybe you don't want to do to close something. So remove everything, basically remove everything you don't understand, you're not sure about, and only keep the commands you were using. So you want to open an image at the beginning, you want to apply a Gaussian blur, then we do thresholding, which is a couple of commands, and then we want to run analyze particles, and we want to put another lookup table on top of this. And I will now close all the windows I have open here. I also close the ROI manager, and I also close this table. I don't want to save. I move everything to the side, so I hide the recorder for a moment, right? And now I click on run. And there's an error message, and the error message is just, we have just to read about it. What is it telling us? Line number 16, analyze particles. There are no images open. So it is now in this line here, and it cannot run analyze particles because there are no images open. Obviously, there are no images open. So why are there no images open? And again, we look not just at the line where there was something wrong, we also look at the lines before. And the line before, the line just before says close. So it is closing a window here, and afterwards it complains that there are no images open. So I'm not sure yet if this close command here is really necessary or not, so that's why I just comment it out for a moment, and I click on run, and I execute it again, and then my results look reasonable. So I'm now sure, okay, the recorder recorded a close here at that point, for whatever reason, right? I don't need it, so I can remove it. And then I have my fully functional program, which opens an image, which applies a Gaussian blur, which thresholds the image, does connected components analysis, and actually also feature extraction, because it is delivering me some actually shape measurements of this particular data set. And then, I mean, a potential next step is you take a data set and you want to define what measurements are taken. Let me also clean up the recorder from time to time. Clean it up from time to time. Cannot say it often enough. Clean it up. you take your data set and we want to do a particular measurement. So far we were just doing measurements, but I didn't define what I want to measure, right? So I go to the analyze menu, I click on set measurements. And for example, I do not only want to measure the shape, I want to measure the area as well. So I click this as well. And here again, you see it is recording some configuration I did in this particular dialog. So let's look again into set measurements. So you see here now, I ticked the area. So I ticked the area checkbox. That's why it says area here. I ticked the shape descriptor method checkbox because, and that's why it says shape over here, and then it records some additional stuff from down there. So basically you find in the recorder the values of these entries or the values you changed, and the activated checkboxes or the first word of the activated checkboxes. And again, it records the same. And then this would be a line I can now here, I crop it in this case, Control X. And I put it into my program just before measuring, just before calling analyze particles. I say just before set measurement. So I want to configure what to measure. And if I again close all my windows, and click on run, I get now also the area and the shape descriptors. So this is how programming in ImageJ works in a very basic way. Please train that because you will get used to it. The basic idea is you take the recorded code, you put some comments in between, also put some empty lines in between as you can see here, and try to understand what this recorded program is doing, because you can read from the code what it's doing, and it helps you understanding how programming in ImageJ works. One more thing, and that might be important at some point, especially when programming a more complex workflow, is switching between windows. So assume you have one window open, or let's do it like that. I have a program which opens one image. So that's the command you just saw. And then afterwards, I make a new variable, the blobs image variable, and I call a method here, and I put the value of this call. I execute getTitle, and what the result of getTitle, I put it into this variable. GetTitle gives us the name of the window, the headline of the window. Then I open another image, this one, and then I can call SelectWindow with the title from before, and it will activate my window again. You may have realized that whatever we do in ImageJ is always done on the currently active window. So if you want in a program, if you want to switch between different windows because you want to do a measurement on this image and then you want to take the value and put it on another image, this is how you do with this getTitle method and the SelectWindow method. You find also both on the cheat sheet. Before we now continue, I would recommend you doing this a couple of times, for example, by processing the blobs.image, see what's recorded, try to write a program which does exactly what you are doing, and then afterwards we will continue here on conditions and loops. See you soon.